Hello, everyone. Nice to see you all here. Thanks for coming. I've heard you are interested in news graphics, in creating data visualization for journalism, and I'm happy to tell you more about that. I'm going to give you an overview of tools, tools for quick graphics, tools for high demands, and then we get a little bit of maps. And I will explain you how to use the tool Data Wrapper I'm working for. So who am I? My name is Lisa. I've created data visualizations for several newsrooms, as you can see there, Spiegel, Bloomberg, Zeit Online. This is like kind of the work I'm doing. You're seeing I'm coming more from design. And now I'm a very happy employee at Data Wrapper, where I'm mostly blogging, actually. I'm explaining journalists like you how to make better charts. I'm also organizing the data visualization meetup in Berlin, where I'm based. So if you ever come to Berlin, please come and be a speaker there. It's okay. Yeah, okay. Doesn't matter. Wow. Okay, so why should we create data visualization in journalism? I think most people who do that can agree that there are two main reasons why we should create data visualizations. The first is to understand the data, to actually see what's in the data and then to find a story. And the second one is to then communicate the data to the final reader. So the first one looks like that, very messy, and only you will understand what's in it. And the second one then transports the story, communicates the story to the reader on your website or in your print magazine. So I have very many, many tools that do exactly these two things. This is just a selection of them. So there is like any spreadsheet software, LibreOffice, like Excel, Google Sheets. And then there are like more code-based tools like R and Python and QGIS, which is more for maps. And then when you want to present something, there are tools created by a newsroom. There's Data Wrapper, the charting tool I'm working for. There's RAW, and then if you want to, and then Twitter as an illustrator. And then I'll explain all these later. And there are some tools, some companies that try to find a middle ground. For example, Plotly is a company that tries to do both, like that tries to be the one tool for analysis and for presentation. Same with Mapbox and Tableau, which is more for business intelligence. And I'd like to distinguish these two kinds of tools in like the tools that try to do one thing right, for example, Google Sheets, and the tools that are super, super flexible, mostly because they're based on code, like R and Python. These are the free ones, and I think all of them except Google Sheets are open source too. Most of the other ones are freemium models, are based on freemium models. And yeah, these ones will be the one that we will look at first. So the tools for quick graphics, meaning the ones that do one thing right. Yes, Data Wrapper, because that's where I'm working at. If you want to, I see no one of you actually brought your laptop, as I said in the description, because you're all not used to workshops at this conference, because it's mostly like a panel conference. That's okay. I'm going to show you what to do with Data Wrapper. So this is how the website looks like. Yeah, you can see these are the charts that one can create with this tool. We are used by several newsrooms like Zeit in Germany, or like the Times, Swiss Info. And you can see they look all very different because we planned these charts for them. Yay, this is a chart, super interactive, with tooltips and stuff. And you can hover over these things to see what's happening here. Many clients around the world, like every single tool. And we are free if you have less than 10,000 views on your charts per month. And I really like to use that tool for a workshop, and I did that before I started working there last November, because you can create a chart and you can create maps without signing in, so that's great. This is how the charts look like in the wild, like embedded in an article. This is by Zeit Online, so this German newspaper. So let's make a chart. Okay, I'm gonna make the chart because you don't have your laptop with you, but we could make a chart together. The data is also about Germany. It's population data. There is like this really nice thing by the German statistics institution called D-Status. And it looks like that. They made this really nice tool. It's like, boom, you can see a population permit from like 1950 to 2060. They have projections until 2060. And it's really great because you can see how much the population is aging over the years. But this is a tool. This is a tool that's not a story. We want to make a story out of that because we're journalists. So let's do that. I uploaded the data on this URL if you ever want to use that data. Let's just have a look there. It will look like this. Make that big. Yes. So from this website, I downloaded the data here and cleaned it up a little bit, and then it's in the spreadsheet where we can use it. For every single year, we have the share of the population that's under 30 years old, that's between 30 and 60 years old, and that's over 60 years old. So in 1950, there were like 15% of the population that were older than 60 years old. So we can just take this data and put it, I'm going to open an incognito app tab to just use the tool as like a total newbie. We can just click on create a chart and paste our copied data here. Ooh, where is it? There it starts, yes. Okay, it looks a little bit messy right now, but it will be cleaned up here. Yeah. And you can see Data Web automatically recognizes in which format your data is. So the green stuff are like dates. And then if it's blue, it's like a number, and it also shows you a little histogram that shows you how your values in that column are distributed. So, okay, we want to see charts. Let's proceed. Yay. That's not bad. Let's try other things. Like, how about a stacked bar chart? Oof, okay. Yeah, maybe that's a little bit too long. Maybe that's actually not a great idea. What else? Maybe a dot plot? Oh yeah, I didn't know. Okay, not better, not better. Okay, let me a pie chart must be it. Yeah, okay, let's actually go back to, oh, maybe an area chart, because that like turns it around, right? Oh, that's not bad. Yeah, we can definitely see a development here. So yeah, the population over 60 got like older, and they are like didn't get older, but they got more. And then we have the population under 30, and there's like a smaller share now in Germany than there were like 50 years ago. Okay. That's also not a bad idea, but I think we can show even more when we go back to the lines. Because here we can see better than in the area chart that one like share is actually overturning the other one. Like there are more people over 60 than under 30, which is a great thing that the area chart can't show us. Because it's like, yeah, you can see, like, I guess that's like kind of a little bit bigger than this one, and here it was like the other way around. And here it's definitely more intuitive that you show shares. Like, people will see better that it's about percentages than in lines. But in the lines, you have the story. Yeah, and I think this one, I don't think we need this line anymore. So we can go back to the data and can hide this 30 to 60 year olds. If our story is just about old versus young. So yeah, let's do that. Let's hide the column from the visualization, then go back to the visualization. Yeah, that's better. Okay, now we can refine our chart. Yeah, there's nothing to do here. We could, for example, say we want it still on a scale of between 0 and 100, but that doesn't make so much sense here because we can't see well, like here. It's better to understand how one overturned the other one. We can customize our colors. Let's turn it off. That might be a nice idea. You can still, yeah, like red versus green. Blue is nice. We can also make them bigger. So yeah, now you can see them. we can change the interpolation, that's not necessary here. It's a nice tool to play around. We can also have line symbols like on every single point, which doesn't make so much sense here. So let's just do the first and the last and make them a little bit bigger too. Oh, maybe not that big. And we can also annotate our chart. Our chart definitely needs a title, which in the best case is a statement. Like, what do we want to show with the chart? I can't type well with just one hand. More old people than young people. And when actually, like, let's see, in 2019, it seems, according to the projections of the German Statistics Agency, in 2019, the old people will overrule the young people and they will get into oblivion and won't be existing anymore. Anyway, and then in the description, we should write down what it actually shows, like the share of young and old people. I'm going to show you how I actually like what is actually a really good example at the end. The data source, the status, this is the German agency, and we also have a link here. Let's put that here. It's important so that our readers can later go to the data themselves and can understand them themselves. And my name is Lisa. Lisa created the chart. And you can see that down here. That's where it turns up. Nice. Okay. Line labels, yeah, they're on the right side right now, which is nice because here we can also see, like it's nice to label stuff directly. That's like easier for the reader, like it has like the less the distance between what you show and where you say what it is that you show, the better for the reader. So we can put it also at the top, but then the reader wouldn't be like, oh, population 60 years old, where is that? And there would be like a really big difference, really big distance. We can put it on the right though. And if we have like a mobile view, data wrapper will put it automatically at the top, which is a nice thing. So let's also, because we want to be like a little bit more honest with our data. I think we don't actually know what's going to happen in 2016. That's just a projection. I think we should make that clear. So let's add a range highlight here. I think in 2014, like the data is a little bit older. In 2014, they started a projection. So we can say, okay, that is the highlight range. And we can add a annotation. Let's put that here. And we can say, okay, this is a projection. Oops. Yay. And we can also style it a little bit if you want to. Sweet. Okay, that's our chart. It doesn't look so bad. In the last step, we can just take that data and embed it. And if you want to embed a story, you need to sign in. I will show you though how that story looks like in an embed way. Because I actually did exactly that chart in the one blog post a while ago. Yes, here it is. So that is the final chart I created. You can see that I actually use the annotations, not just to put like that word projection up there, but to also label all these lines directly. And I also put like the difference between female and male share of the population in there. And you will also find that in the spreadsheet, if you want to. That's how it looks like. You can see the statement is also way better. because we can see now that for women, it's already the case that there are more older than 60 old women than younger than 30 old women in Germany. And for men, that will be the case a little bit later. Exactly. If you want to, you can also edit this chart here, so you can get directly in the chart on all the stuff on our blog. And here I can show you how that publish and embed step looks like once you actually logged in. Yeah, you can publish the chart. And then it takes a few seconds, which we will remain silent. Yay! Yes, and you can share it now, like it's It's going to look like this. You get a page on which your chart is, which is neat. And you can also embed it as a responsive iframe or like a normal iframe in any CMS. Sweet. You can duplicate it, PDF and PNG. Yeah, I think that was it. Thanks for following along. But if you want to, you can definitely create that chart again in your own, well, with DataWeb by yourself, now that you have the data. But yeah, I will tell you more about other tools because, of course, this is not the only tool that exists. There are lots of DataWeber-like chart tools that actually are built by newsrooms themselves. So, for example, the New York Times has Mr. Chartmaker, the NZZ has Q, the Financial Times has Nightingale, the Globe and the Mail has Chartool. They all build their own charting tools. And often they're just like internal, so you can't use them. You can use Chart Builder, which is a tool by Quartz. And it looks really simple. It's like basically, yeah, like DataWeber, but with like super stripped down of lots of functionality. And you have everything on one page, which might be nice. So if you see a chart like that on Quartz, it's definitely created by their own internal newsroom tool. Yes, and now you think, okay, that might be too basic, right? Like, what about this stuff? This looks so much better, so much more interesting than a simple column chart and line chart and like these things. Well, there are tools out there that make that possible. And the easiest tool is definitely Raw, which I will also show you. But you won't get an interactive graphic at the end that you get like with D3JS or like DataWeber. So yeah, I'm going to use RawCraft too to quickly show you because I'm actually a huge fan of that tool as well. It's totally open source. It's built by Density Design in Milan here in Italy. And yeah, everything is on one page, very simple. You can paste your data or you can try example data. So let's take data about the music industry. Yes, because you want to actually create a chart very similar to the one we just saw here. Okay, it gives us all the data. Yes, great. Okay, and now we have super, super fancy chart types that we can use. They look really good. I would say it's harder to understand them by readers, so be please very careful with that. Like a sunburst chart, I mean, this is like a little bit advanced. Box plot is something that mostly statisticians would use. Yeah, horizon graph, you'd really need to know what's going on here. Basically, that this is multiplied on top of each other instead of stacked on each other. Stuff like that. It's a little bit harder to read, but okay, let's make a steam graph because it's for time series. And then you can drag and drop stuff here, like for example, year, date, just that. Yes, and now we have a chart. We have a chart that shows us which kind of medium was like most successful in the music industry between 1970 maybe and 2010. So we can really see that the CD was super successful, far more successful than all these tiny things that we have right now. And we can play around a little bit with that too. We can have like linear, that's a bit better. Now we don't have these wobbles anymore. Basic spline, what's that? Oh, that's even better. And we can change colors and make them extreme because it's fun. In the end, you get a SVG code. Again, it's not interactive, or you can get SVG or a PNG, which is a nice thing because, a PNG you can't really change, but with an SVG, you can put it in another software like Adobe Illustrator and you can clean up, for example, these labels and make them better. So I guess it's a tool that mostly print graphics people really like, but it's also nice to just play around with your data, with these fancy charting tools, with these fancy charting functionalities. Yes. Okay. Oh, that was it. Okay, this was also like a good segue to the tools for the high demands, meaning the ones that are super flexible and powerful, and they often rely on code. So we have Arnia that I want to quickly introduce, and we have D3JS, which is super important for graphics people in journalism. So, okay, that's how R looks like. Intimidating. Well, that's how R Studio looks like, which is basically the software in which R code is used by most people, I would say. And that's how a typical graphic in R looks like, created with a library of R, which is ggplot. So it's a little bit more advanced, but it's great for analyzing data. And it's better than, for example, Excel, because you have a documentation of what you did. So you can see here that you know exactly how you manipulated the data, why you did that, and you can tell your readers afterwards, for example, oh, I did that, and here that makes a lot of sense. So yeah, that's not something you can use in your news articles. But people actually do that. Like 538, for example, build their own library to export graphics in their design. So if you see something like that, that is probably built based on R. Although this one, they definitely also put in Adobe Illustrator, which is this one, and clean it up and put like the annotations there. Because this is possible with R, but it's super, super hard to do. R is really more like for analysis. But yeah, 538 puts it more like in this presentation row, which is very, very interesting to see. And makes a lot of sense for 538 because they are so like data-driven. Okay, Adobe Illustrator, not good for charts, really not good. Adobe Illustrator is made for making logos or like illustrations based on vectors. And they have like a charting functionality, it looks like that. That's how much space they give for the charting feature. It's really not awesome, and everybody's still waiting for Adobe to fix that and make it better. Okay, and now the holy grail, D3 chairs. D3 chairs, yeah, looks like that. If you're not a coder, that's not looking nice. It's also not looking nice for me. I've heard once that somebody said, D3 is basically built by smart people for smart people. The learning curve is steep. Like, you really need to understand some concepts very well before you can do stuff with it. But if you want to do stuff with it, like for example this one or like this stuff, this is like so much better than your normal column chart and so much more advanced, and you put like some weeks in it and you have like a bigger project, then D3JS is the thing that everybody uses. And how everybody uses is basically, well, a lot is like copying what other people did, because it's like all out there, it's all open source, and just tweaking it a little bit and then like Googling how to make it better and how to improve it. Yeah, if you want more information, d3chairs.org. Yes, and you can see here like a nice comparison of what it means to code in R versus what it means to code in d3chairs. Remember, R is for analysis, right? That's just to understand the data. And d3chairs is then, when you understood the data, you then put it here and make it available for the public. It will be responsive, it will be like interactive, you can do all these things. But it requires so much more code to just do that. Then here, I even loaded a library here, which means I loaded an extra thing, and then I created this chart very easily with just a few lines of code. And the other one is just so much longer for basically the same chart. It's the same data, it's the same chart, but the bubbles are smaller on the left side. Yay, okay. Maps, let's make one. Because maps are also like super important for journalists, they're often local, they have their local newspapers, and then they want to show what's happening right in front of your doorsteps. So we're gonna use DataWrapper for that again, because there's also a nice mapping feature, and we're gonna use age data again, like population demographics data. Because now we know, okay, there are more old people in Germany than young people, and everybody's dying out, but we don't know where this is happening. We don't know the geographical pattern yet. So I went to this website here, wait. This one, and again, I put the sources here so you can go there yourself. And I downloaded an Excel file that looks like this, which is great, because it has like names of districts in Germany, and it tells us the median age in 2015 in these districts. So again, I cleaned it up a little bit, but not much, just to remove some columns. And let's get into our data wrapper again. Okay, it's just gonna go to data wrapper again and create a map instead of creating a chart. Looks a little bit different. Here it asks us if we want to make a choropleth map, which is a very complicated term for just this normal map, you know, where you fill regions with colors that represent a number. Or if you wanted to make simple maps. Okay, choropleth maps. And now you see like many, many things, many maps you could make, like Europe, or EuropeNuts 2, or EuropeNuts 3, if you want to be really detailed. We have a map of the Middle East, which I built. I also built cartograms, which I'm super proud of, so I'm going to show them off. So for the US, for example, we have these things. Maybe you've seen them around. Okay, but we want to make a map of Germany, of districts. Okay, we have them for several here. Let's take these ones. Yeah, that looks like a map we want to make and want to fill with data. Now it's time to add data to your map. Okay, let's do that. We're just going to import our data set. I mean, we could put numbers in here and it would change and it would update, but this is like a little bit too much for all these districts that Germany has. So let's import our data set. Yeah, now it tells us which kinds of IDs it needs. We have like this AGS thing, which is like a district code. And we do have that too, or we can have names. Let's put them in here. Okay, and now it says, oh yeah, that district code, we actually found that and it matches with ours. So that's nice, sure, next. Column that should be visualized on your map, okay. This one, yes, the median age. We want to fill these regions with colors that represent the median age of the people in this district. Okay, congratulations, oh, thank you. Cool, that's our map. Looks like it says a lot. well, it doesn't yet. We definitely need to change a little few things to make it actually say something to us. And that's mostly this feature here, the color palette. We definitely want to tweak that. And we want to say, okay, yeah, that's better. Oh, okay, now we can see something. Oof, that's a little bit too much. So you can see the more you go to the bottom, the more extreme the contrast becomes. These are called like stops, and we shouldn't overdo that. Like I think the differences are not that big. So let's just say, okay, maybe quartiles are good. Yeah, we can definitely still see things. We can see that in East Germany, everybody seems to be super old, except in the cities. And again, we should put that statement up here. So young peeps live in the West and in cities. Yeah, but it would be great to actually know what the median age exactly is for these people here. So let's do that. Let's add tooltips. You can do that here. We can write stuff that will appear in every single tooltip, like district. But we also have these things here at the side, which are like our column headers. These are exactly the things we had here. District code, median age, district name. Median age, district name. And we can, if we put them in, we can just click on them, district name. The name of each district we hover over will appear. We will see that in a second. So the median age, I'm gonna put that away. Yes, okay. Let's see, oh yeah, that worked well. Median age in this district is, okay. Now we can see that. We can also make it a bit more fancy with like HTML code, if you know that one. I'm gonna show you, it's like pretty simple. Okay, what I just said now is like make it super big so that we can see the number better. Oh, and maybe we should put years afterwards. Years, these are years. They are 47 years old. And in Berlin, they are 42 years old. It's actually not such a big difference. So maybe this is a little bit more honest, yeah, to decrease the contrast. Yeah, you can do, we should maybe make the map key a little bit better. 40 years, yeah, this is like the age, median age. Yep, okay. And we can remove that zero. Alrighty. Oops. And like in the description, we can put again, like what we, what it is actually, median age, things like that. And here we will put the source and here the byline. Lisa made that chart. Cool. Are there any questions so far? Yes, you have a question. Should I give you a microphone? I can come to you and you can speak in my microphone.
Thank you.
No,
another one?
This is also a good microphone. I like my microphone. Okay.
Thank you. Just one question about the geographical levels. Mm-hmm. Is there the possibility to add some shapefiles except the ones you already have?
It is not. You need to tell us which shapefiles you want, and then we will look, have a look. And then we will add them for you as soon as possible and make them available for all users. We will probably add that feature at some point. Maybe not with shapefiles, maybe with GeoJSONs, but yeah, that's gonna be. Yeah, we get it a lot. Another question? No.
Thank you. I have a question about line charts.
Line charts, yes. Let's go back to line charts. What's your question?
I have been trying to put some annotation to a specific point of the line, mm-hmm. and was wondering how I can do that. I tried with an annotation and an offset, but it couldn't adjust them to be responsive.
Okay, so you want to put an annotation, for example, here on this intersection, but with an offset?
Just to put the annotation at the right place.
At the right place? well, if you put it there, here are all the annotations. It looks a little bit more complex than what we had earlier. We can add an annotation and put it right here. And now it's like bound to this thing. Like it, you can actually see it's like actually exactly at these positions. It's like at 2013, like the 11th month of 2013. And then the height is like 40. It's like at 40%. Is that answering your question? Guess it's not. Yes. You still look confused. You can change it also here. You can say, okay, this is, you want it at 30. And now it goes down to 30. Or like maybe 50 makes more sense. And now it's up here. Yeah, and it should stay there. Like it's still the same, even if on the mobile view, it's still the same. And yeah, what you said about the offset, if you're wondering about that, that's what she means. You can say, for example, put it five elements, five units more to the right and five units up or like down, yes. And now it's like bound here. It's like bound to this position. Yes. Any more questions? There's a question.
Hi, a question again about the maps. So you have your own shape files already in the system. Is there a way that you can see what actually is in the shape file so that you can make sure that the spelling of the district is compatible with what you have on your Excel spreadsheet?
Yes. So if we go back at your data, you can see here what geocodes are available. Whoa, okay, yeah, the resolution is not awesome. And you can see how these IDs look like if you choose them. So the IDs for the names look like the actual names. And then we have numeric, which means they don't have a leading zero. Oops. And then as a text with a leading zero. Because often in Excel, it takes away the leading zero because it thinks it's a number, so we also added it as just like a number, because in this case it works. Nice. No more questions? All right. I can continue. I mean, this is basically kind of the end of my presentation. I guess this is really, really important, and I just want to make Sure, everybody gets that. If a reader doesn't understand your chart, it's your fault. If your coworker doesn't understand your chart, it's also your fault. Make the chart better. It's really, really hard to make good charts because you are in that data. You've worked with the data for like 2 hours or like 2 weeks. You know the data by heart. And then, you know, you put it in there and you're like, everything is clear. It's clear for me, so it's clear for other people too, no? It's not clear. It's not clear. Make sure to make, yeah, to put like a good description in there which explains what's happening, what are you actually showing, where does the data come from, what did you leave out in the data, stuff like that. And make sure that you have like a good headline that makes the reader curious about the data and also tells them what's happening and what he's supposed to see in this data. No more questions about that, Aina? Okay. This is the end of my presentation. Everybody who wants to leave now can leave. I think I still have 10 minutes. So I can keep going about what keeps the community awake at night, which is also a topic I'm very interested in. So, interactivity. This is a little bit an older discussion in the scene. I'm really a big fan of the scene. Yeah, I'm organizing the DataViz meetup. You know, the community is important to me. So I'm really interested in the conversation that's happening, that happened in the data visualization and data journalism scene. And interactivity was a big one, especially like 1 or 2 years ago. So Archie, which is like the head of graphics people at the New York Times, he went to a conference in Spain and said, if you make a tooltip a rollover, assume no one will ever see it. They actually tried to find out, like they tracked how many people actually clicked on button and used interactivity. Turns out only 10 to 15% of the readers will actually ever click on your buttons. Most people just look at it. And I mean, I've seen that many, many times where I'm like always the one who hovers automatically over stuff, but my mom doesn't. She's just looking at it and I'm like, move your mouse, move it there. But she's not doing that. So yeah, lots of people actually go in the direction to putting annotations directly on top of the graphics. That's what the Financial Times is doing. They're doing amazing stuff, I'm a big fan. And they're just making basically static graphics. They use T3 to create these graphics, but like, I don't know, 90% of them are without any interactivity. It's also something you can share wonderfully on social media, way better than interactive stuff. Big projects versus daily projects is a big pain for a graphics team, I would say. Because you have like a team, you know, like a DataViz team, a graphics team in a newsroom, and it makes like one big project, and then the editors are like, ooh, that got so much traffic, that's amazing, I want that too. So more editors want graphics. And then graphics people are like, okay, now we can't do the big stuff anymore. We're gonna build tools for editors to make it really simple to make like a line chart or a column chart. And that's why so many have them, like I had like the list earlier, NZZ, Quartz, New York Times. And the graphics people, or the graphics people build smaller graphics, like at NPR that's the case. They don't have a tool available for journalists, but they get emails. Here are four numbers, can you make us a bar chart? And they do that. So they have no time for big projects, which is why they actually wanted to be hired by this newsroom in the first place, which is kind of sad. Better tools. I showed you a few of them. I said it's only a selection. I wrote like 3 blog posts about where I compared 24 tools with each other. And yeah, what I found out, and then I put them on like this axis. It doesn't matter so much what I would say is still true is like that these drag and drop apps, like these drag and drop tools, like DataWrapper, are still there for like the simple stuff. And then if you want to make like super flexible stuff, you need to learn D3. Or like ggplot, these things. It's a little bit, you know, you still need to go to, if you're a journalist, you still need to go to a graphics person if you want to make a really amazing big thing. And archiving. Technology is like just advancing at such a speed. That's a problem. Like these things, we won't be able to see them anymore in 5 years. Like I wanted to see like a really old New York Times graphics recently, and it asked me to install Flash. And I'm like, oh yeah, Flash, that existed. That existed at one point. I'm not sure. So it was like a pain to see it. I could still see it, but that won't be the case like always. So people some people think, okay, we don't need to because this stuff is old, you know, I don't want to see that anymore. It was like very nice in the moment because it was like about news that happened in the moment and now we don't need it anymore. But I would say, would be nice to have like a documentation of what we did in the last 50 years or so. We would say that in 2040. Yeah, if you want examples of projects and Twitter peeps to follow, etc., there is like a really nice list by WebKit, which is a data journalism agency in Berlin. They did a great GitHub list, awesome interactive journalism. And if you want to know more, want to learn more about tools, then I can recommend you that article I wrote. But this is like 1.5 years old by now. So there are new tools out there, like Flourish, maybe you've heard about that one, which try to also bridge the gap between flexibility and like still simple to use. They're still pretty new, but yeah, it's nice to see the tool world growing and like finding solutions for stuff I mentioned earlier. Yes, and we're here again. Nice. If you have questions, just come to me. I'll be happy to answer everything.